क्यों तेरा मन गए वहां? Each and every entity of mysterious and miraculous creation of God, we see lot of homogeneity, heterogeneity, disparity and parity, integrity and repulsion, federal work, collective work, composite work, parallel work, contrary work. Various these experiences we are seeing in ecology. And for each and every entity, the characteristic, the physical as well as chemical as well as ecological, what are these characteristics to do with the nature, the structure and function of each and every entity, and how they are distinct. Each and every, what we call vastu, swarupa, swabhava, guna, vikara, vibhava. Each and every entity, its structure, its functional nature, its federal nature, its transformation nature, its collective nature, its destination and resettling, all of these things are based on a phenomenon which is scientifically, rationally, philosophically known as selection. And there are two types of selection. One is natural selection and artificial selection. Natural selection is what we call in religion and philosophy a divine selection or a divine will. And in general science or rational, it is considered to be natural selectivity, which is not enforced by a third element. And this natural selection, whatever that is there at the time of the crude creation as well as the expansion of the cosmos, the second expansion is known as civilization. The first expansion is the cosmic expansion, in which various life forces, life structures, as well as their abodes and substratums have been evolved and they have been processed over several millennia. The second type of expansion, I told civilization, the civilization has contributed much for artificial selection. Why it is like that? If it is having a flaw, why can't we remove that? If it is having a character, why can't we identify and make it more productive to us? If something is not responding to this, why can't we make it respond? So this type of both crooked as well as clairvoyant, that which is time oriented, that which crosses the barriers of needs of present with the futuristic, that which restores and assures us long term benefit, cyclic benefit, assured benefit, unalloyed benefit. So this type of artificial selection that has just sprung from the curiosity, which is of two types. One is a clairvoyant or perspicacious curiosity. Second is a crooked or collapsed curiosity, by which we have tried to implant as well as implement lot of possibilities against the rules of nature and also under the latent rules of nature. There are two things. If there is cotton and if we weave and make it in the form of a cloth, it is not against nature. It is a process by which we make things in a desirable form, in which it is permissible even by the latent issue of the nature itself. So what are all we are doing by means of our innovative measures, by means of our additive measures, they fall under two more categories. Apart from these two curiosities, they fall under two more categories. One is that which is silently sanctioned by the nature itself. How we can identify the silent sanction as well as the silent repudiation? We can identify very easily by means of its immediate, mediate or remote impacts on the ecological and biological factors. We can understand whether it has been sanctioned or de-sanctioned. So this type of sanction is understood by people and it is known as productive use of science or efficacious use of science or salubrious use of the science for the welfare of the society or the total ecological system. And it deals with different steps. One is identification, and second is use, third thing is multiple utility, fourth thing is upgradation, fifth thing is multiplicity or multiplication, sixth thing is control, seventh thing is extirpation, eighth thing is customization. These are all the eight characters of artificial selection, in which we identify things
we upgrade things, we customize things, we multiply things, and we control few things, and we extirpate some unwanted or pernicious factors. These are all the limbs of artificial selection. On the basis of which, the industry of vegetation, that has also seen these various stages or phases of transition and evolution. That which is there in the crude form, what we call terminologically indigens, they start with indigens, which is a natural, unprocessed wild product, which has resulted in now we are having cultigens and cultivars. That which is processed by means of a human intellect, that which is by the architectonic evolution for a human infusion, and that which has been specifically processed and the variety has been fixed with a nomenclature system, that is what we call cultivar. So that indigen has developed into cultigen and cultivar now, and depending upon the need of the growing population, number one. Number two, need of the non-conducive ecological factors which are governing as a substratum for development of the industry. There must be some sort of conducive munificence that is showered by the nature itself. Then if we are growing, as well as the factors which are substantially contributing for the development of the consumers are growing, the consumption will also grow. So the productive elements and also the conducive elements, they must also simultaneously parallelly grow. But the factors that are determining the multiplicity or multiple or polylevel productivity catering to the need and expansion, further expansion for the society, they are just subjected to declination. So we have to get these things for three reasons: due to the expansion of the population, as well as contraction of the natural conducive minimization shower towards the hyper productivity of the essential crops. For three reasons it is behaved and believed that artificial selection and its intrusions is more essential and indispensable at this era. And number one, to have more productivity, that is known as yield or munificence. Number two, to develop more resistance to fight against the factors, that is eco-resistance and bioresistance. Eco-resistance deals with temperature and other factors, bioresistance deals with pests and other unwanted intrusions. So these resistance should be developed. And third thing is amplitude or processing promptitude. So apart from getting into more yield, which is known as munificence, and more power to withstand the non-conducive as well as colliding factors to its solubility, longevity and productivity, that is resistance. And number three, it is processing promptitude. So to fix a limited time frame for more productivity with more rich in nutrition as well as the withstanding potency or resistance to go against the non-conducive factors that are biologically and ecologically presented inside that. So this has resulted in two major systems of thought. One is known as the school of domestication, second is known as school of acclimatization. The school of domestication is that which is grown in a specified unorganized atmosphere to bring the same thing. What is the difference between a plant and the crop? We used to say in Sanskrit, Veshaja, Aushadha, Sthavara, Virudha. They appear to be synonymous, but they are different. That which is just a member of the botanical kingdom is known as Sthavara. And that which is having some divinity is known as Virudha. That which is having medical value is known as Veshaja. That which is having supportive value, that is Poshana, by which it grows us, that is known as Aushadha. Aushadha, Bheshaja, Virudha and Sthavara. Likewise, if it comes like that, it may be a plant, just a general name. If you cultivate systematically, it becomes a crop. So it is a process by which they are domesticated, they are acclimatized. And that is what we call wild connectivity or wild crop relatives. For each and every crop that we are using now, there will be some, just as the Homo sapiens for the human race in the genesis process or the theory of evolution of Darwin, each and everybody, they will be having a parental species. Likewise, there will be certainly a wild crop relative which has been accustomed, and by use of utility, they have been brought into domestication. Second thing is acclimatization. Acclimatization is altitude. Second thing is temperature. Third thing is soil type. Fourth thing is hydro, that is water requisition. Then photo, light requisition or sunlight requisition, whatever it may be. So all of these various things, they constitute the ecological factors. So we want some specific altitude. We want some particular soil type. We want some nutrient some nutritious content value specified. So that which can internally govern or stimulate an inner force, just as we are having the homeostasis inside our body, to develop the inner status of adaptability, assimilation, multiplicity and distributive value of the essential nutrients, which are governed on the basis of factors like temperature, altitude, sunlight, water and various other factors of the soil type, that which is internally governable so that it can adapt any system at any type on any ground. So certainly it proves that the growth of a plant, the sustenance of a plant, or the perfection or this nutrient precision of a plant is conditional. To make something, to adapt any type of conditions by means of inducing the inner driving force, by means of going to the primordial factor of characteristic destination or determination known as genes, and by means of a transcription, retranscription and extirpation of the encoded message by means of a decoding, recoding and encoding process, the characteristic viability as well as compatibility that which already exists in the system is boosted, twisted or tuned. And this is known as artificial selection, and this type of selection is now growing in modern astrology. It started with the first hybrid era. It started with Gregor Mendel and Charles Darwin. Then it entered into heterosis, the theory of heterosis. Then the third era is M.M. Rhodes. He has made the cytoplasmic male sterility phenomenon, that is the CMS. That is the era of M.M. Rhodes. Then came the plant tissue, that is the plant tissue culture. The plant tissue culture means it has a narrow axis, narrower axis, wide axis, wider axis. There are innumerable axis status for this crossing. In wider crossing, we can have even heterogenic compositions, like triticate. We are having the triticate, the new hybrid cereal, which is a hybrid of wheat and rye. So like that, it comes in the era of the plant tissue culture. Then there is the era of chemical mutagens, like EMS, ethyl methane sulfonate, and dimethyl sulfate DMS, and radiators and transformers. These things are chemical mutagens. Then we are having the protoplast fusion and the latest chromosomal engineering. And the advent of molecular engineering, it has contributed a lot of things in molecular biology. By means of, just now he has mentioned about markers. With the DNA fingerprint, we can induce millions of characters and differential behaviors of a system. Thousands of things we can incorporate at the same time. Simultaneous incorporation, effective incorporation, orderly presentation, systematic and precise value determination, infusion, fusion and mixture. Everything is possible by means of this DNA fingerprinting. It is known as molecular marking. It is also ruling now. Now, there is a system of reverse breeding now. These people, they know better, and double haploids. The recent thing, and a very recent thing, the new bride of the development of plant genetics, that is genetic modification, in which a desired gene, a wished gene that is introduced inside by the removal of an RNAi, and the transcription is promoted by a promoter, as well as the termination sequence of stopping the transcription is also embedded inside simultaneously for the desired phenotype model. So it is there now, very much available for us. And now recently, the rDNAs, that is the genetic recombination system, is coming. Now we are entering into pharmacrop era. That's what I delivered a lecture on pharmacrop. In pharmacology, I have selected the topic of pharmacrop, in which after 10 years, we did not take any medicine at all. First, we have been taking good food in good environment, and we had lesser opportunities to take medicines. Now, we have both medicines as well as food in equal status, qualitatively and quantitatively. Now we are going towards such an era where we are consuming more medicines, both in quantity and quality. We are consuming more than the plants. Now there is a pharma era. Certainly I want India to develop a lot of things, because this gene mutation, gene coding, gene inclusion, fixation, these things can be universal. But identification of these things as per the Indian traditional herbal system by understanding various other potential herbs like Vitania somnifera, Osimum sanctimum, Osimum basilis, Avena sativa, they are all very powerful. And we have a strong record of herbaceum. We have a good materia medica. By understanding the principles of which we can produce pharmacrops. The pharmacrops naturally, they deal with a customized system to various other environmental repulsions, as well as behavioral repulsions, as well as etiological repulsions that naturally happens. For example, we can create such a crop which has more fiber content, which has more things that to do with anti-cancer, to anti-diabetic, anti-nephral, anti-neural, what are all the various problems that are persistently testing the society, to create an inbuilt, just as with they created induced pesticides in BT crops, like they developed BT corn, etc. In new emerging crops, they induced inbuilt pesticides. That is, they can create, the resistance mechanism has been induced and fermented in such a manner that they can create their own antigen to take care of the pathogens that are there in the environment or that attack their structure. Likewise, these pharmacrops is the very recent area where we have to ponder more, wherein by we need not require a triad. One is a food to live, and second is a medicine to take care of the disease, and third thing is a doctor, a multi-expensive system, lot of trouble that we see. Disease is not cruel. Diagnosis and treatment of the disease is more cruel than the disease itself. Lot of the treatments and diagnoses, people used to say that I am happy. Are you clapping by your experience or something? No, most of the area. No, I have heard the patient saying that taking these medicines or taking this treatment or diagnosis is cruel than the disease. I am better with the disease itself. So we can avoid various other unwanted intrusions, except some unavoidable these things, we can escape from most of the things. So for natural survival, we need food. That is dharana, poshana and bhogya. Dharana is that governs your salubrity. Poshana is that governs your metabolism. Bhogya is that gives you taste. So we get everything by means of these pharmacrops. It is just a very great bheshaja. It is also an aushadha. It is also a virudha, what I have told now. So we can get biological support for metabolic activities. We can get survival mechanism, and we can get also the medical substitution which we are getting from so many unreliable and pernicious sources. We can get from standard and stable sources. So this is the greatness of pharmacrops, and certainly I believe that one day we are going to organize a seminar on pharmacrops. Certainly pharmacrops, that is going to be the emerging era. Then, just as he has quoted about various pattern issues, whenever you develop things, whenever you develop in the advent of science, you simultaneously used to face problems. They are unavoidable. Number one, it is cross-expectational or cross-desirous behavioral change in the expected elements. It is either expected change or expectation change or behavioral change. Whatever we think that we are genetically modifying, that it is productive, that it is behavioral as per the expectation, that sometimes misbehaves. So there is no surety. Even now, most of the people in gene mutation, especially even in nanotechnology, the behavior of the nanoparticles in the drug, digital drug drive, as well as morbid region drug delivery systems and digital drug delivery systems, they are told that now we are feeling and finding safe. We cannot assure how far we have reached inside this genetic process and nano drug process. Both in biogenetics they have assured. So now whatever we have done, because now there was a very great rebellion that has been caused by this BT Brinjal. Lot of people, they protested against that recently, happened everywhere. Like most of the people, like BT cotton, lot of the farmers, they cultivated lot of such products. So farmers' expectation, scientist expectation, social greed or wider expectation, that has been nullified by the product. Because whatever that has been injected, that becomes nullified, number one. That does not behave at all. Number two, that behaves, but only to a particular time. It is ephemeral, it does not behave so. That is not deeply incorporated in the continual or peripheral or consecutive cycles of the productivity level of that particular gene. If it is there in the product X, then in the various productive consecutive level of the cyclic generation, the behavior is not repeated. It has four types of different behaviors. One is novelty. Apart from our expectation, it has a new behavior. Second is diversity. Apart from our expectation, it has other behaviors also. Third thing is adversity. It is quite contrary to what we have expected. Polystructuralism, it has adversity, it has controversiality, it has novelty, so it is a blended medley of everything, etc. So this behavioral nullification or this behavioral or expectation change is the first problem. Second problem is its impact on ecology. That is now still a debate. That is in the ethical this thing like nanoethics, geoethics, like agroethics and bioethics. Or genoethics in genetical engineering, we can start a new issue also. Now the debate is going on like that. So its impact on ecological factors. Third thing is its sustainability in the status. And fourth thing is the farmers and their assurance of the benefits. And the fifth thing is what we have discussed now. It is the breeders' rights, intellectual rights and other problems. So these various issues are still in debate. And no doubt whenever you start something, there will be debate, there will be dissolution, there will be solution, confusion, everything occurs whenever something develops. We have to take hold of all of these things and we have to come into the real pathway. And then coming into this in the form of genetic engineering. Now, we used to address about this genetic engineering even in our Shastras, that is entirely different. That is already I have told about natural selection and artificial selection. Even in Putra Prarthana, we used to pray for a specified, a customized, a tailored progeny. I want to tailor my progeny. But that is something mythological or mystical or philosophical, which is far beyond a rational view or common view. And this thing is very much artificial. So whatever we are having, for example, if there is a cloth, then we can stitch any pocket, any size, buttons you can place as per your desire of count, place and structure. You can do anything like that. In this genetic technology also, we can do anything. That's what now they believe, but it is not so. They've been cheated by the nature. Number one, it is very simple, just as there is something which we want. You are taking something you want. There is something which we don't want and you are removing that and you are adding the same thing. It is very common. But to do with the genes, it is not very easy. So there will be a discarded gene. There will be a discarded gene which we don't want at all. So the discarded gene is removed. There are certain enzymes. They are known as promoter enzymes, adhesive enzymes, remover enzymes, then pushers and pullers. Innumerable works are done by enzymes. So these remover are scissors-like enzymes that will remove the discarded gene or DNA. That discarded DNA will be that place like this. Then there will be a donor DNA in which it is ready to offer. And that particular thing is removed by a process. And that becomes the desired gene or the desired DNA which you want to include. So like the genetic engineers which are there outside, there is Agrobacterium tumefaciens, which is the natural genetic engineer which lies in each and every project. In each and every particle or each and every process, there is a natural genetic engineer. So whenever you take a donor gene and you are taking the, there are three steps. Take a donor gene, discard the particular portion that you want and make it as a desired particle separately, number one. And these so-called, I told, Agrobacterium tumefaciens, it is having a round independent rotary structure known as plasmid. And that plasmid, if that is cut off, as it is something connected with the presumptuous infection of creating crown gall and other pernicious infections, that particular area is discarded, removed. Then that becomes the open plasmid. Then that open plasmid is connected with the desired DNA and this structure becomes a full structure. It is known as recombinant DNA. And this recombinant DNA is mixed with the plant cells by means of which the new generation with the recombinant DNA factor reflection that comes as plantlets. So take a donor gene and take the desired element from that. Take a malid as well as a malefic element and discard the unwanted thing and to make it the open plasmid and annex it with the wanted or desired gene. And to make it affixed with a system of plant cells which are ready to imbibe, then you are creating new plantlets. It is like a Ambulimama story and very interesting to hear. But there are some problems. genetic engineering has advantage for we can understand the genes by means of natural selectivity process to create an offspring or to create a lineage of genes. It will take number of generations, which is time consuming, process consuming, risk consuming. No doubt it is not your risk, it is the risk of the plant system itself. So it is like that. That is an advantage. Now by means of genetic introvision, we can have the capability of identifying the specific gene amidst thousands of properties. That capability is there with genetic engineering. But there is one thing, you are having the capacity to intrude things. So now you are discarding the unwanted one, making it open. Then you are separating from the donor gene the desired DNA, and you are affixing it to create a generation itself. That you are doing. But there is something which is in the hands of the plants, that is known as adoption, reflection, or reaction, or behavioral expression. It is known as behavioral expression. It does not mean that whatever you do, it will be accepted and you can modify anything for any cause. It is not so. So even you are doing, that's why I used to call, doctor is the servant of the body, he is not the master of the body. He understands the synergy, allergy and energy of the body, which is accepted, which is very much assimilated and which is negated by the body. He understands and he prescribes the medicine, knowing the language or knowing the command of the body. So there is a pre-instilled command. The scientist is knowledgeable because he understands the command. He is an obedient servant because he goes by the command. Even if he creates a new command, to create a new command is once again a command that is given by the product itself. So there is a lineage of subservience even in the status of alteration or upgradation. That is the thing. Now recently they have made some soybeans. Recently they have invented some soybeans in the European countries, and it is by gene mutation and gene intrusion. Now apart from the two genes which has come from the fragmentation of that original gene that was induced, now they have found out new short fragments of unspecified or non-specific genes. How they came inside? It has automatically, incidentally occurred in the transformation process for which they have not calculated, they have not specified. So apart from that desire, that direction and calculation, the nature in its transformation process reacts. That is known as the behavioral expression. So whatever you do, the behavioral expression and adaptation is in the hands of the plant, and a real person is to understand what it is really doing. And number two, whatever that are now we are developing antibiotic resistant genes. Now also that Food and Agriculture Organization and World Health Organization, they have done a lot of research on that, on two things. Number one, whatever the protein that is left there in the food, in genetically modified things, that food or the protein that is released, that which is stagnant inside, that may react with the oral antibiotics of the person. That is the first problem. Second thing, that may induce the process of a bacterial synthesis in the intestines. Now they are just saying that no, there is an appetite juice, and there is a digestion juice, and there is a processing juice, and there is an assimilant inside the body, the gastrointestinal system. They used to just mitigate and dilute these things, and they can disintegrate the possibilities of their microbial infection later. Now they are saying so. So there are innumerable processes like that, and even in the development, now they have stopped this genetic modification even. They can do it with a shotgun method. With the pellets of gold and tungsten, they can do just with a shotgun method, very recent method that has emerged. And even by means of a medium which is a nutrient base, they can do with a petri dish with a small tissue, and the tissue can be implanted and can be developed. So a lot of these wonders are coming. But how much it is applicable to India, how much it is required to India to customize the system? No doubt, whenever something is developed in other systems, if you criticize in the name of orthodoxy or the principles of, there are four principles. One is the principle of nature, the advocates of nature. Second is advocates of orthodoxy, the old traditions and other thing. Third is advocacy of ethics. Fourth is religion and philosophy. Whenever science and technology develops, these four people, ethical people, they come for questioning. The people representing the nature, they come for questioning. The orthodoxy, the traditional values, apart from mere religion and philosophy, they are also coming for this thing. It is social orthodoxy, not religious orthodoxy, social orthodoxy. Number four, religion and philosophy is also coming there. So blindly considering all of these people to be superstitious, that is also wrong. And taking each and every word into consideration and not developing the country, that is also wrong. Once we have to sit and tabulate where they are superstitious, where they are super institutious, that we have to classify where they are really correct and where they are wrong. Today we have been discussing with N.S. Ramaswamy, who told it is there in symbiosis. Symbiosis is paraspara sparsha vivekaha. Plants, they like few bees. And few structures, they like plants. There is a symbiotic attraction which is symbiotic in nature. Likewise, there is a particular type of, it is not an enzyme, it is a type of force, subtle force which is created by means of pressing of gokshura. What is gokshura? Gokshura is the foot or the limbs of cow. And rishabakshura is the limbs of brishabha, which is ox. So from bullock and ox, the sparsha in the land itself that induces a subtle potency which is not measurable by ammeter, voltmeter and galvanometers. So whatever that is done by a gentle embrace or a gentle, you know the difference between touch, contact, friction, pressure, collision. Everything is similar, but the depth or gravity is different. So the gentle trodden measures and the embrace of cows and bullocks inside the land, it induces real fertility, aroma of the land, instead of unwanted compacting and compressing the soil structure. But practically to the grown civilization or the expanded society, how many cows and bullocks, how many years we have to do that work? So the time frame, the expansion in the society, their unaffordability to place and govern. If there is a machine, we can put some diesel and we can do that. And using livestock, it is very difficult. But we have to develop. What is the final essence of the message? Development is nothing but sacrifice of values and traditions. Development is nothing but sacrifice of values and traditions. And sacrificing values and traditions is nothing but sacrificing values like experiences like peace, harmony and joy. Sacrificing peace, joy and harmony is sacrificing human nature. Sacrificing human nature is just like being inert like a stone. Just being inert like a stone is purposeless and meaningless. That's what we are living. And if we have taken the vow that we have to live like that, by our own wish and vision, certainly we have to adapt all the things. But try to create a bridge between tradition as well as the modern technology so that we can get both the benefits. They are not contrary to each other. They can be contributive to each other to some extent. We cannot totally mix both of the things, and that which we have to create. Regarding India, you know that it is the second largest agricultural center with 16.6% of GDP, with having 60% of the major workforce indulge not only in agriculture but also in forestry, in logging and fishing and other substantial accessory activities. But the problem is, we are having innumerable problems which we have to certainly present in this concluding session. Number one, the first problem is over enthusiastic or the over contributing subsidies to the agriculture itself is, it is contrary to the development of agriculture. One is the subsidy. Second is the over-regulation. Third thing is cost prices rising. Fourth thing is environmental risks. Fifth thing is the social disharmony and disorder. Sixth thing is lack of reforms in land, financial principle and other policies. Then low infrastructure or poor infrastructure of land and irrigation. The size of the cultivable land or the cultivated land is not sizable. Now, that is also a problem. Technology is a problem. Irrigation system. Now, 2004 report, they have given 56.2% is only irrigated. So, irrigation also created an irrigation divide in the arable lands. So, how much it is done? By soil erosion. By increase of soil invaluability. Aridity. So, all of this horrific soil has become an arid status. And that is the reason to various other things. And also problems, practical problems like insurance. Now there is an agricultural insurance system. And also agro-credit given by banks like NABARD and everything. So these things are the various social, structural, environmental issues which has catered to that. Apart from that, the greatest menace is the government. That's why we have to organize all programs in non-government organizations and without inviting any political people. Number one, the government is very much interested in getting ease from the various credit crunches that he is facing. It is having a lot of credit crunches. That is very much interested in easing itself from the credit crunch. And also to promote the stock market and to gain more investors' confidence and reliability, it is working more. And The poor farmers, they are not considered at all. And if some farmers are benefited, certainly there will be, already there must be beneficial farmers. Already those who are beneficial and rich and stabilized, those farmers, the real thing, the policy goes for poor farmers. But the profit and benefit reaches only for big farmers or those who are having farming as their hobby. And those who are having something political lobby. So those who are having this hobby and lobby, these two people, they are benefited in the agro benefits and they are not anywhere concerned with the masses. It is a real thing that happens in the society. Even at the time of the international price hike of all the crops, there was an agrarian crisis here. Even the international market that was performing very well, but there was an agrarian crisis. That is the problem. Number one, everybody is happy that the farmers' loans are settled by the government itself. It is just an eyewash. Really, what I want to say here is, up to March 2009, this financial year, more than 3,90,000 crores are of farmers' outstanding it is pending now. And even it opposes something else. What is that it is opposed? The purchasability, payability, or repayability, or stabilization of farming is opposed. See, if you are just cancelling all the loans, the credits that have been given to the farmers, instead of intensifying the farming facilities inside, that the same amount, if it would have been contributed for developing farming there, withstanding the loan itself or making the loan payable with more holiday period or more extension period, then they would have been developed. The real development is to make them to have the repaying ability and to have them the possibility of constructive farming that has not been assured. And just it has been cancelled. That is number two. And number three, it appears that they have given a lot of things, but fresh loans are not given. You have cancelled the previous loans. What they will do? They have to do farming. Why they did not pay the loan? Because they did not have money. Now they have to do farming. For that they need money. Without your paying of further loans or extension, how they will do that? Cancellation for a political gymnastics or for an electoral show, you have done something really not benefiting the public at all. So it has not contributed to the migrant workers as well as the farmers or the cultivators. And even it appears that the government has done a lot of things to farmers, it is not so. Government is doing all formalities to farmers and facilities to industrialists. Just formalities are shown for farmers. Facilities are given only to industries. So the industrial loan was 48% and 9% is the loan that is allotted from the loan settlement process of the government to farmers and 14% for personal loan. So when you take a comparative look, when you take a conservative look, when you take a strong look, we can understand how it is different from each other. And one more thing, now recently, the bank, Reserve Bank of India, they have allotted some loan structure. 3,20,000 crores was allotted, out of which 2,75,000 crores was allotted to non-food sectors. 2,75,000, and Mr. N.S. Ramaswamy, he knows even the livestock management and livestock organization is fitted inside the agriculture. How much they are contributing for the livestock is very well known to the people who are working and fighting for that. Likewise, even agriculture, they are fighting for livestock which is inside the agriculture. Even in agriculture, there is a battle. So, more for non-food sectors it is given. And one more thing, the stipulation and duties that were there on rice, that has not been lifted. But for iron ore, they are lifted. So, this can clearly show how much they are interested in industrial development and other these developments, we can easily, very easily we can understand. Now coming to the final point, even at the time of the so-called expected 2008 food crisis, the hyper-productivity of our Indian arable lands and the hard work that has contributed a lot of cereals, cotton and oil seeds, and we have saved the India from food crisis, and this greatless government has not repatriated its gratitude in magnitude. That is the problem with that. And all of these rural projects I have given in many lectures, all of the rural projects are not for benefiting the rural people. It is for transport, transaction of all the other urban goods by just tempting the persons to purchase, not making a needy purchase or a purchase with real intention or qualified intention or purchasing ability. Qualified intention is not there. No need is there. They will be starving for food, but they will be having mobile phone and bike. What is that? So there will be no intention, and the intention is not qualified intention. There will be no purchasing ability. All the road putting and expansion and other marketing systems are only like that. It is only temptation marketing of the rural areas done by the urban industries, and nothing is so solidly done. And how we can create, there are a lot of commissions. Commission means there are two meanings, you know that. So commissions like Dr. Alak Commission, then M.S. Swaminathan Commission, Sen Gupta Commission, innumerable commissions they have made. And these commissions, they have given a lot of reports that now we are having lot of unreleased agro credits. Among 1 lakh crores of wealth, 60,400 is given to the industrial development. Only 10,400 has been, 11,000 is allotted to the agricultural development. So they have given three principles. Number one, immediately to release the fullest agro credit available to all people. Second thing, there is a small affected group, vulnerable group. They are known as marginal, small, medium farmers, MSMF. For these people, we have to refinance because otherwise they cannot develop. And for irrigation, storage, power systems, and for developing the transportation needed for their own agro industries, 25,000 crores that is stagnate with them is to be immediately released so that they can effectively do that this thing. These three things have been denoted even before 5 years, even before 1 year, even before 2 months, and no commission. All commissions have been put into omissions, and it was not properly heard. And coming to my subject, psychobotany, we have to deal with the plants as living beings. It is known as Uttama Janma. Yesterday I told something about plants. It is known as Uttama Janma. Those who had done the virtue as well as the sin. It is a composite reflection of sin and virtue, punya and papa. There is a human being, that's what I told in one seminar of karma. There is a human being, and as per his special nature, he is advanced as a human being. As a human being, even though he is great, he will be suffering like a dog. So his standard of living, that is living standard and special standard. So he has done some punya, some virtue, primary virtue which has destined his body to be human. He has done some, he has made some sin which has destined his standard of living. The special standard is determined by a primary or dominant virtue, and a submissive or subservient sin that has rooted or framed the structure of standard of living, which is very pathetic and which is very deplorable. So there are dogs comfortable than human beings in the embrace of so many great media icons, politicians and other so-called worshipable celebrities of the community. So we are having all of these people. Like that, even if a person is sinful, suffering in spite of being human, that is virtue based on sin. If there is a tulsi, no doubt, as it is thavara, as it is a botanical species, it may be or it is inferior to human standards. But it is being worshipped by all people. Cow is worshipped, bilva is worshipped. So even though they are infraspecial in nature, their standard or their way of respect that they claim as per the shastras and beliefs of the people, that prove that they are supernatural. They are extra or exorbitant from the nature of the special limitations. Likewise, plants are specially blessed entities. Those people, those who worked for the society, those who wanted to work for the society, those who have done also a pinch of unintentional or unknown sin, they are born as plants and serve others. And their quality of being plants is determined by their unintentional cyclic bondage of few sins, as well as their service to the society is based on their intentional charity or the inbuilt magnanimity that they had executed in the previous birth. That's why we should say it is known as Nishkrishtotkrishta Janma. It is Nishkrishta by means of its special standard, Utkrishta by means of its productivity. That's why we used to know as Nirvikara, Paropakara, Sthira, Poshaka, Jagatadhara, Barada. These are all the names of Stavaras. What is Nirvikara? If some insect or any other organic, there are three matters. One is material or chemical matter, and second thing is vegetative matter, third thing is organic matter. Whenever you see any other life form like insect or any other animal or bird that is collapsed, immediately you will feel something vijugupsa, which you call vijugupsa. We will feel obnoxious. But whenever a plant is collapsed, it is nirvikara. It has no vikara at all. Vegetative matter does not create any vikara. So that's why it is known as nirvikara. And second thing is paropakara. It can develop lot of things for the society. Yesterday I told, it gives temperature control to the world, it gives the global warming to be subsidized, it is a good cloud allurer, and it takes the carbon dioxide and produces oxygen by balancing the alternative ways of survival between sthavara and jangama community in the world. I have told everything, etc. It is a poshaka, it is a varada, everything, etc. So it has a feeling. It does not mean that somebody, there are two extremities. One is extreme cruelty, or it becomes otherwise a whimsical or a fanciful methodology of compassion. Even if the compassion is there, that becomes very whimsical and fanciful. And treatment of cruelty means extreme cruelty. So there are two extremities. And somebody asks, if all plants are having lives, then we are stepping on grasses, we are stepping on ants. It is too much. So sir, that which is intentional, that which is non-processive, and that which is accidental, that which is unavoidable, these things are entirely different from intentional act having some sort of malice and avarice. Malice and avarice is entirely different from actions of unavoidability and unintentional status of the processing of evolution or livelihood in the society. So we have to classify these two things. Like a Buddhist, we cannot be just cleaning all the way where we are just moving in the earth. We cannot do that. So plants, there are worshipable plants. The Shastras say, if plants are having feelings, they are having life, they are having pain and pressure, they are having attraction, repulsion, we are eating plants. So no doubt we have to kill the plants. And we are getting lot of things through the plants. How it is possible? What is the ethical definition for that? There is a very wonderful definition given in the Shastras. Number one, Pratividya. What is known as? Pratividya. Second thing is known as Prayashchitya. Third thing is known as Prakriya. This Prakriya is very much known. You take to the amount you want, you take to the specific amount you want, number one, that is Parimiti. Second thing, you take that particular part you want, Avicheda. You take that particular amount you want, don't exploit it much, so that it grows or it processes by its own. Even lot of people are there, they will cut to the stem level and they will take something. So, Vicheda and Avicheda, Aparimita and Parimita, that differentiate between proper use and exploitation. So take the amount you want, take the particular portion you want, this is known as Prakriya. Prayashchitta means daily we used to pray to God that intentionally or unintentionally, for the sake of our survival, even though that is a divine will, we have to qualify ourselves for taking that product from earth. That is a very wonderful thing. It is known as qualifying one's own self for survival. We have taken water from the world. The Vedic way of life is entirely different. We have taken some water from the earth and we are using it. And without using the water, there are two things. Without using the water, you cannot survive. The existence of water itself is for your purpose. So certainly you have to take that. It has been created for you. And you cannot be without that. So there is a natural binding. Why we have to do worship? Because you must qualify. That is qualified to contribute something to you. Apart from mere qualification, for example, in cinema I have heard a dialogue. What qualification you are having to marry my daughter? I am a male. That is the answer. Is it the only qualification required for a marriage? So, the ability to give nutrition is the qualification for the plants. But mere ability to use the nutrition is not your qualification. That is a female, there is a male. It is not the immediate qualification. Capability to take care of the bride is the qualification. Dignity to preserve, ability to preserve social dignity and domestic dignity is the advance or the additive qualification expected from the bridegroom. Likewise, it can give benefit, what you can work for him. Yes, if he gives money, I will take. If he feeds, I will eat. This is not the qualification. So apart from getting from the nature, being a proper representative by means of an ethical person in usage, distribution, conservation, preservation, and multiplication for the future generations, these five activities, that gives you proper qualifier. If you take like that, it is bestowal. If you don't take like that, it is betrayal to the nature. So what we want? Not bestowal, betrayal. So, unless you can develop plant genetics and any other sciences, any other advanced sciences, you can go to the pro genes or even subgene level. But without understanding the most subtlety of the ethical balance of the society, unless you qualify in governing a plant, number one, in giving it to all, number two, making it available for the others in the future also, number three, fourth thing, while doing these things without disturbing the eco setup, these four qualifications, if it is not there, then certainly it is a betrayal. So, mind, morale, music and mantra are the four forces with which we can mix with nature. Mind, with real mind, placid mind, tranquil mind with reflecting natural unalloyed mental ability, one can approach the plants. Second thing is morale, the principle and way of life. You know that natural unalloyed mental ability, one can approach the plants. Second thing is morale, the principle and way of life. You know that Jay Krishnamurti, he has written in his autobiography, wherever there is a garden where a carpus plant, it is not giving the carpeti, that is a fruit, wherever the flowers are not properly there, envisioned in flowering, that is crops or plants or shrubs or herbs, wherever those things are stagnated, wherever those things are totally withered off, wherever those things are non-productive in any part, either in growth or giving flowers or fruits or vegetative growth and vegetative mushiti, there Krishnamurti is properly invited by his friends. And whenever he touches and feels and internally communicates with those systems, immediately they have personally experimented as well as experienced that they started growing, they started giving fruit, they started flowering, they started budding, they started developing the leaves, they started germinating. So all the other various things, apart from a natural process of agronomy, it is a process of psychoagronomy in which the mind and the pure and potential impulses of the mind, that also negotiates with the nature. But we may ask a question, there are 100 acres of paddy farm. How long it will take for me to communicate with each and every paddy, and how long I can develop some sort of system? It is mass communication. You are studying MA mass communication. Even if it is 1000 acres, even if it is 10,000 acres, even if it is a wide single globe, Mother Earth, we can communicate. Sarve jana sukhino bhavantu. Urdhvam jikadu bheshajam. You can communicate with any number of elements at any number of acres on any number of vegetative heterogeneity in mixed farming or even placement farming or poly farming or whatever may be the structure. You can communicate with anything. That is mind. And music and mantra, these are all the special representations of the same mind. A beautiful mind is itself a music. If your mind is beautiful, then it is music. If your mind is powerful, that is mantra. That's what Tolhapier, he says, mantra is nothing but the potency that is orally revealed by a capable, sturdy person. Any person who is principally, practically sturdy in his nature, and that potency that is orally revealed is known as a mantra. So, the beauty of the mind is music, and the efficacy of the mind is mantra. And the placid mind consists of overall affection, which caters for all-round happiness. And morale is governance of the principles in the surroundings. So, apart from the various other engineering process, we must develop a type of engineering which is psycho-engineering, which is phono-engineering, and which is ethical engineering, by which we can create the really trouble-free world, wherein by whatever you are facing, obscurity, obtuseness, long-term unassured benefits, immediate side effects, we get all effects. After effect, before effect, side effect, upper effect, lower effect, except the desired effect, we get all the other effects. To get the desired long-term, primordial, perennial and perpetual cycle of benefits to all of the people, we must know how to intrude with ethics, that is ethical engineering, how to intrude with an eco-balance, that is eco-engineering, how to deal with our melody and potency by mantra and music, that is phono-engineering. Certainly we have to make new courses, at least for the believers, the so-called astikas. There are more than 80% astikas who are just candid astikas. Candid religious people are 80%. 15% of the people, they are clandestine theists inside, and the 5% of the people, they are shuffling between these two centers. So lot of people, they are believing mantra, they are believing music, they are believing ethics. While coming to the practical view, they are overruled by uncontrolled emotions or their needs in the form of greed and violence, due to which they used to go for something which is not their true nature at all. So this genuinity encroachment is due to their aberration from the arbitrary fixation of Acharya Parampara and Deva Parampara or Upasana Parampara. So either they must surrender to somebody or somebody else should embrace them so tenaciously clutched grip that they will not go and they will not be aberrant from the arbitrary axis of religiosity, morality and ethicism. So this is how we have to create the world, and which this is the India Century Mission. We have to teach them eco-engineering, phono-engineering and the engineering which I have already explained now. So coming to this final point, I believe that sthavaras, unless, yesterday I told, if you plant a sthavara, that is equal to construction of a temple, that is included in Ishtapurta. Construction of a temple, making Ashwamedha Yaga, Bhudana, Godana, Swarnadhana, all of these things are there in Vrikshasthapana. Likewise, Vrikshacheda, yesterday I told, Vrikshacheda is equal to Gohati, Pashuhati, Strihati, etc. So we consider that planting a plant is as auspicious as constructing a temple. And killing or uprooting a plant is as heinous as killing a cow or killing one's own mother or killing a woman or something else. So we have to understand this ethics of our life under road expansion, habitation, other unwanted things are there and wanted things are there in the society, wherein by planting of trees as well as taking them, dismantling the trees or crushing the trees are unavoidable in the expansion of population. So there must be a simultaneous governance. Wherever we used to deroot some plants or trees, simultaneously we have to develop social forests, herbal parks, etc. So I believe that we can take the initiative of developing this phono, eco and ethical engineering through our traditional system for the real welfare of the mankind at large. Naran, naran, naran.